Psalms 33, 5 and 6. The Lord loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of his unfailing love. And by the word of the Lord, the heavens were made, their starry host by the breath of his mouth. Won't you stand as we sing this morning? Day, right? We want more of those. We do practice open communion here in Southwest, so if you're a first-time visitor and you've accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, we invite you to take part in that a little later on in our service. Also, please fill out the tear-off tab on your bulletins and let us know if you have any praises or prayer requests so we can share in those as a church family. Randy and Mandy are in Barcelona right now. They're waiting on a flight to Dubai and then on to, I can't even pronounce it, Dar es Salaam. And Randy just says has a great service and he's thinking of us all. So we want to be in prayer about that a little later on our prayer time and throughout the service as they prepare to travel today on to Tanzania to start the work there for the water well. So we're just so excited about that. We're also excited that Tracy Thomas is here today. Many of you know Tracy from Woodlawn Christian, and he's now at Lincoln Christian College. Let me get this right. Director of Partnership Development. Director of Partnership.
You may get a promotion.
Representing. Right? There you go. Well, he should be director. So we are so glad he is here today to bring us the message. Let's just open with a word of prayer.
Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the beautiful weather you've given us this day. For this is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice in it. Father, I lift up Tracy today as he brings us your word. Father, just speak through him. Give us receptive hearts that we would hear and spiritual ears that we would understand. We give all our thanks and all of our glory, all glory to you, Father, for all you've done and for who you are. Just have your way in the service, and we ask it all in the name of Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Won't you turn around and give somebody a hug, handshake, or smile?
Yeah.
come to our prayer time this morning, we want to keep just Randy and Mandy and the entire family and the team in prayers as they get to Tanzania, as they get to Kisambala, as they begin the work there. We want to pray that just all the resources and everything they're going to need just falls into place, that they can get that water well accomplished while they're there, get the pumps there, get the tanks there, and just get everything working well. So we just want to pray that that happens. So we just pray for those provisions, logistics, and for their safety and guidance. Just continue to pray for revival for our sons and daughters. And just a hunger for prayer for God's word, evangelism, and God's holy anointing on this church in A180. Our homeless shelters in town, and Angel Cove, and all the churches in our community. I want to continue to lift up on our health issues, Krista Bircher, Jack Buchanan, and Dave Capps, Chris Hilberry, Diane James, Glenna Johnson, Phyllis Johnson, Leslie King, Herman Levy, Jackie Rector, Bella Reynolds, and Marilyn Smith Peters, Aaron Steele with his foot healing while he's on that trip, for Edwina, for Ashley, and our cancer patients for Dwayne and Jackson Morton, Melon Stanley, Gene Phillips, and then Mike Moore also. We also want to be in prayer this morning about the boys over there in Thailand that are trapped in that cave. I came to church a little early, so I'm not sure. They had two out when I left. Someone said they had four or six out now. I know it's still a very dangerous and treacherous thing, and we rejoice that they're out, but we continue to pray that the rest of those will be rescued safely too. So I think there's 12 of them trapped in there, plus their coach. So we just need to pray about that and keep praying about that. Are there other prayer requests, praises out there? Yes?
I mentioned to you earlier a prayer for Rose Boswell, who had lung cancer. She has undergone her surgery, is recuperating, and regaining her strength. So we're looking forward to a good x-rays Monday.
Good. Others?
Adam's grandma is going to see a doctor on Monday. They found a spot on her lung. So she smoked for years. So
okay. That's Adam Desmond's grandmother.
We found an apartment, so we have a place to move in 1 week.
There's a praise for Joy and Josh. Went up there within 1 day or 2 days, found the apartment. So, good. Next big move is the move.
Yep. Right. 24 years ago tomorrow, I stood pretty much where you're standing right now and said, I do.
Anniversary. All right. Very good. Good job. All right, let's go to God. Jesus, we thank you for this day, for the blessings of life. We thank you, Jesus, for just the free gift of grace and mercy and love that you pour out on us. God, we just want to lift up Randy and Mandy and their family and Jeffrey and the whole team that's traveling to Tanzania. Lord, we pray that everything falls into place, that they would just be able to bring the physical water that is needed in that community and for all those people. And Lord, we pray that while they're there too, that they get to witness to others about the living water, and that people will never thirst if they drink of it, Father. So we pray for those opportunities, both physical and spiritual, Lord, that they just all take place for them. Lord, protect them. Father, just let those resources be there to get everything done in a short period of time. Lord, we also lift up in Thailand today the young men that are trying to get out of that cave that's flooded. So, Father, we just pray you be with the divers and you be with them, and that all would be returned safely. God, we thank you for this church. We thank you for this church family. Lord, we pray for Tracy this morning as he brings the message to us. Let him just impart to us your will today. And God, we just thank you for the blessings of life, for all that you are, and all that you will be. We pray for all these that we've mentioned, Lord. We lift them up to you for the physical healing and just that peace beyond understanding and comfort that is needed. But Father, most of all, we pray for spiritual health of each and every one of us. And it's in your name we pray, Lord. Amen.
It's a place where you're I can't do two things at once. That's why people know I have a hard enough time talking. So, thank you. I just didn't want to break anything.
No problem.
This time of communion is a time when we give our thanks to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And as I was getting ready to put everything together, some of you know, probably getting to become my favorite artist is David Crowder. And when I go on my walks, believe it or not, to try to get a little exercise, I always put him on, and it puts me in such a great mood. And this song that we're about to hear, it really goes into my message, how we are to come as we are, meaning to come to the table as we prepare to give ourselves to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And I thought we'd play this, and then I'll go into the message for everybody. Kinds of sin are sometimes called sins of commission and sins of omission. It is a sin to lie. It can also be a sin to know the truth and not tell it. It is a sin to speak evil of someone, which is also a sin to avoid him or her when you know he or she needs your friendship. And we should be willing to help as the Holy Spirit guides us. And if God has directed us to do a kind act, to render a service, or to restore a relationship, and do it, you'll experience a renewed and refreshed vitality to your Christian faith. And that's kind of like the one thing that has touched my heart over the years. And matter of fact, I think it was Carolyn one time, or maybe Marilyn one time, we had a meeting here. And they were needing people to volunteer to help serve. And I was like, okay, what do I do? 2 days later, one of them, and Mandy called and said, well, we got something for you. And from then it increased little by little by little. And then when people ask me, what do I do in church? I say, well, I do everything but preach. Which is probably a good thing to many of you. Because you don't listen to me anyway. But that's my greatest pleasure is to serve our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And I get so much out of it. And it means the world to me. And knows that people look up to me. And I never would have thought years ago anybody would look up to me. But, the kids love me, you guys love me, and my Lord and Savior loves me. And that's why we do it. So let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful, glorious day. Each and every day you give us this wonderful, glorious. We ask for your blessings on Tracy and his message, and more importantly, how he spreads your word to us, to open up our hearts and our minds to you, and also too that we take that message outside these doors of your church, dear Lord, to those who are lost, who have yet to come to know you, so that we can open up their hearts and minds to you, our loving Savior, and it's to you we give all peace, honor, and glory, and we thank you for everything you've given us. In your name we give all praise, honor, and glory, dear Lord. Amen.
Thank you. That I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first moment until now. Being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion in the day of Christ Jesus. I have a confession to make to you. I've always wanted to be Superman. And this is me, circa 1978, with my Superman cake. I had the Halloween costume when I was a kid, complete with cape and everything. Now, don't get me wrong, other superheroes are cool. Okay, Batman is awesome, but nobody touches Superman. I wondered, it must have been hard, so I thought, it must have been hard for Superman to become Clark Kent. All of those incredible powers, and he had to hide them. I can't imagine what it would be like to lower yourself that much. I was actually Clark Kent once, for real, I really was. In eighth grade, in our speech class, we got to use an actual video camera. Now, this was the 1980s, when video cameras were kind of, sort of, new. And I remember I was supposed to go into Perry White's office, and I was supposed to go in and say, "What's up, Chief?" But as I went into the office to say, "What's up, Chief?" Do you remember those plastic mats that were under your teacher's chairs when you were in school that the teacher rolled the chair around? Well, that plastic mat was off to the side, and the chair was not on there. So when I got up there to actually say, "What's up, Chief?" I hit that mat, and I went flying. And I literally landed on my, I was like, "What's up, Chief?" And I ended up flat on my back. And you know, it was recorded on Betamax, you know, for all the world to see. If you don't know what Betamax is, just Google it. But it was recorded on Betamax for everyone to see. I even got to, because I got to wear these stupid glasses to read, I can do this for you. I even got to go to the closet. You remember the old show, George B. Show, you know? I got to go to the closet and go, you know? And I love that. But I got to tell you, sometimes being Clark Kent's not funny. You know what I'm talking about, right? The times you wanted to save the world but couldn't. The times you wanted to fix someone else's problems and realize that you're helpless. You want to be Superman, but you're stuck being Clark Kent. You put on the glasses and you live a normal life, and yet through it all, the world cries out for Superman. I've often wondered if that's how Jesus felt. When the crowd wanted to stone him, he walked away. When the Pharisees mocked him, he didn't destroy them. When they placed a crown of thorns on his head, he loved them. When they hung him on a cross, he forgave them. You ever wonder if Jesus got tired of being Clark Kent? We're going to be hanging out in Philippians chapter 2 today. It's going to be up on the screen. If you want to open up your Bibles or your apps, that would be great. In Philippians chapter 2, starting verse 5. It says, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. The same mindset. Paul uses this word a lot in Philippians. In fact, if you have your Bible open to Philippians chapter 2, in the first four verses, he uses that word three different times. He says, be like-minded, being one in spirit and purpose, having one mind, consider, value others better than yourselves. Those are brain words. When Paul says, have the same mindset as Jesus, what he says is, he says that love is not an emotion. He says that love is a choice. Love is a decision that we make. And I want you to see the decision that Jesus makes. And the reason why I want to show you today this decision is because I want you to understand what it means for you. Because after we find out who Jesus is and the decision he made, there is a therefore. And it translates to you. Hang on, we'll get there. Philippians 2:6, who being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. My old Bible said something to be grasped. He wasn't reaching for greatness. He already had it. He was Superman, large and in charge. 2 Corinthians 8 tells us that Christ became poor for our sakes, so that through his poverty, we could be rich. The most powerful being in the universe became a tiny embryo. A selfless God poured himself out for the creation he so dearly loved. But he wasn't done yet. Look what happens next. He says, rather, he made himself nothing by taking on the very nature of a servant. He goes from the very form of God to the form of a servant. Jesus understood the irony of his selfless choice, but there was too much at stake to do otherwise. I love the famous Ambrose Redmond quote about courage. Ambrose Redmond once said, the courage is not the absence of fear, but rather the knowledge that something else is more important than fear. Jesus understood that. For Jesus to turn the leadership model upside down, he would first have to become the servant he so desperately wanted his people to be. For him to do this, he would have to trade in the form of a king for the form of a servant. He would have to pick up the lintium, the servant's towel, and wash his disciples' feet. And then he would have to pick up the cross and wash our sins away. Jesus was not just concerned about who he was, but also in how people saw what he did. And that's important because we're going to come back to that in just a minute. But he still wasn't done. He didn't just choose to serve his people as God. He chose to become fully human in order to walk with us in the most intimate way possible. I've actually heard someone argue that it was not as hard for Jesus to remain sinless since he was both God and man. Oh, it was easier for Jesus. He was God and man. I postulate to you today, it's harder. If you have Superman's cape under your clothes, how tempting would it be for you to wear? Being found in appearance as a man, my God, my King, the creator of the universe, the one who said, let there be, and it was. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death. Oh my goodness. He didn't just die. Do you realize Jesus did not risk his life for you? He gave his life for you. He came into this fully aware of what was going to happen. I could go up to any of you this morning. I've known Cindy for so long. I could go up to Cindy and say, Cindy, I would die for you. And it's easy to say it because odds are it ain't never going to happen. I can make that statement to anybody I want. I can tell anybody, even a total stranger, I would die for you. Probably because it's never going to happen. Jesus did not come to risk his life. The shepherd did not come to risk his life for his sheep. The shepherd came to give his life for his sheep. He knew what was going to happen. And he wasn't just obedient. He was obedient to death. Deuteronomy 23 spells it out plainly. It's a cursed way to die. Jesus did not get run over by a bus for your sins. Jesus died on a cross. Just the concept of the cross was horrible to people. You realize, right, that that is offensive. Oh, we've cleaned it up. We've made it pretty. But it's offensive. It was not something in Jesus' day that you even spoke about in mixed company. If somebody mentioned it, you took your kids and you covered their ears and you ran out of the room screaming, la, 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 la. Because you can talk about this. The cross was and is today offensive to the world. And that's exactly what Jesus took upon himself. He did not just die. He died cursed. He became that which the Father hated in order that we might become the ones whom the Father loves. Jesus took upon himself the only two parts of creation that he did not create. You understand that? There are only two things in this world today that God did not create: sin and death. And Jesus took them upon himself in order that we might be right before God. And here's the beauty of all of this. Here's the beauty of watching Superman become Clark Kent. Christ chose it that way. Therefore, there is only one whom God exalted to the highest place. There is only one who received the name that is above every other name. There is only one at whose name every knee will bow. There is only one at whose name will be on everyone's tongue. That name is Jesus.
Amen.
Whose selflessness brought glory to the Father. That name is Jesus Christ, crowned as Lord. So I told you that to tell you this. There's a therefore. Because you see, you can look at the cross as offensive. You can be thankful for what Jesus has done for you. You can be grateful for the sacrifice he makes. But if you do not take the therefore and move to the next level, what is it you are going to do if Jesus is who he says he is? Then who are you? What does that mean when you walk out of here today? Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act according to his good purpose. There's a spiritual tug of war in our lives. I love the way Reggie O'Neill described it. In his book, A Work of Heart, he called it a divine human interplay. It's back and forth. This seesaw thing that we call a relationship with God. And I want you to see how that plays out. First and foremost, in our efforts versus God's power. Verses 12 and 13 used to scare me. I'll admit it. I mean, whenever I read this and I read that verse and it says, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling, that verse freaked me out. It did. What do you mean continue to work out your salvation? I don't understand what that means. Well, think of it this way. The Apostle Paul talks about a farmer preparing his equipment, sowing his seed, taking care of the soil, and then waits for God. He knows that God provides, but it doesn't take away from his responsibility. He's still a farmer. He still has a job to do. When we recognize that the growth only comes from God, but the planting and watering, if I read the Apostle Paul correctly, the planting and watering comes from us. I love how the Message puts it. It says, what I'm getting at, friends, is that you should simply keep on doing what you've done from the beginning. When I was living among you, you lived in responsive obedience. Now that I'm separated from you, keep it up. Better yet, redouble your efforts. Be energetic in your life of salvation, reverent and sensitive before God. That energy is God's energy, an energy deep within you. God himself willing and working at what will give him the most pleasure. Paul would say this to the church in Colossae. He would say, we proclaim him, admonishing and teaching with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone perfect in Christ. And then he says, to this end I labor, struggling with all. Struggling with all what?
Pitches.
That would seem to be a place for the Apostle Paul to say, I'm struggling with everything I know. This would be an ideal place for the Apostle Paul to come in and say, I'm putting everything I've got into this. Blood, sweat, tears. What does he say? Struggling with all.
Yes.
Which so powerfully works in me. You and God. In this together. Philippians 2:13, God is working in you so that your purpose and your work line up with his purpose. Mark Kirsch set a world record for the fastest time ever in the harness jet pull. I'll say that again. He set a world record for the fastest time in the harness jet pull. Let me explain to you what a harness jet pull is. On July 15, 2008, Mark pulled a 100-ton 767 jetliner 100 feet in 34 seconds. They put a harness on him, they tied the harness to the jet, and he pulled the jet 100 feet in 34 seconds. And everybody was so amazed when he did that. It was in all of the newspapers, all over the internet. Can you imagine this guy pulled a 100-ton jet 100 feet in 34 seconds? And maybe it's just the cynic in me. I don't know. But I thought to myself as I heard this story, wouldn't it just been easier to get in the cockpit? Wouldn't it have been simpler just to fire that baby up? I bet that thing will fly 500 miles an hour. And I know you're thinking, Tracy, the guy pulled a jet. Okay, fine. Pulled a jet. How many times do we pull the weight of the world when God's energy is right behind us, right inside of us, ready to fire up? Secondly, our attitude versus God's plan. Our attitude versus God's plan. Verses 14 through 16. Do everything without grumbling and complaining. I think my dead text is grumbling or arguing on what you're all laughing about. So that you may become blameless and pure children of children of God without fault and warped and crooked generation. Then you will shine among them like stars in the skies. You'll hold the firmly to the word of life, and I'll be able to boast on the day of Christ that I did not run or labor for nothing. This language here, by the way, is Old Testament. Okay, it's Exodus talk. It's when the Israelites left Egypt and began their trek toward the Promised Land. God frees them from slavery in Egypt and parts the Red Sea for them. But can you imagine what that would have been like to walk through the Red Sea? To see the water on both sides, to get up on the other side. As soon as you get up, the last person gets up, the water comes back down, and the Egyptian army is trashed, and everybody is looking around. They start singing the song. Exodus 15 is a song. It's a victory song. Miriam sings, the horse and its rider, he's hurled into the sea. And they have the most awesome, incredible worship service. A million of God's people sitting there on the shore going, God is awesome, God is wonderful. Do you know how long it took from God is awesome and God is wonderful to you've left us out here to die, Moses. We're dying out here. What if we need stuff? You know how long it took? 3 days. 3 days. You ever wonder why churches have Wednesday night services? Takes about 3 days. Until the excitement wears off and the complaining starts. There's no food! God gives them manna. Manna's Hebrew for what is it? They looked up, they held up, they, all of a sudden it fell on the ground, flakes like frost. They picked it up, they're like, manna? Forgive my bluntness, church, but we have got to stop fooling around with this.
Amen.
Verse 14 literally means without grumbling or dispute. You see, that's how it starts. People grumble. You get in your little circles, you get into your little cliques, and you talk. Randy's fault. with a straight face, we complain that others around us need to grow up and be more mature. We do that with a straight face! Do everything without grumbling or arguing, so you may become blameless and pure. You understand those words are quotes, children of God without fault, the crooked, depraved generation, because that's the song from Deuteronomy 32. The Apostle Paul is singing that song to his audience. And he tells them, church, it's time to sing a new song. Not about being a warped and crooked generation, but about being stars in the universe. Paul leaves Exodus and goes back to Genesis chapter 1. God said, let there be. Stop. Sun, moon, the luminaries. It's what he uses. Luminaries that does not exist for its own sake, but to illuminate the darkness around it. We exist to make a difference to those around us. That's why he uses the words blameless and pure. These words don't deal with who we are. They deal with how we are perceived by other people. Because of Jesus and what he did for us, because of what he wanted people to see, the love and patience and grace of the Father, because of what he came to portray to the world, we now have that same opportunity. Blameless and pure are how people ought to see you. We bask in the light of Jesus and we point the way to the Father. That is who we are. Not groaners, not gripers, not complainers. We are stars in the universe as we hold out the word of life, as we shine the light on what it is that we are and who it is that we serve, so that people will listen and will understand and will trust, because it's worth it. Verse 17 says, even if I'm being poured out like a drink offering on the sacrifice and service coming from your faith, I'm glad and rejoice with all of you. So you too should be glad and rejoice with me. Sometimes shining like stars isn't fun. Can you imagine the Apostle Paul writing this? This is a death knell for him. Within 6 years, he will be killed. He says, I'm already being poured out like a drink. Death, guys. You see, shining like stars isn't fun. You have people who use the image here, they think, wow, you know, Paul's talking about, he's talking about the temple. He's talking about a religious service. How awesome. No, he's not. He's talking about a pagan ceremony. He says drink offering here. He's not talking about the drink offering you're familiar with. He's talking about the pouring of wine before and after a meal in honor of the false gods. He says, you know what my enemies are doing? They're pouring me out. I don't have long to go. The pagans are going to hang me out to dry. But here's what I have decided. I have decided to show the love that Jesus showed to me by what he did on the cross. I decided to show that love to everyone else. I have made the decision that I'm going to love and to serve, and I'm not going to allow happiness at any given moment to determine my relationship with my God. I'm not going to allow the struggles in my, because we think everything ought to fit and everything ought to be good. To be honest with you, most Christians would be happy just being happy. They would. Most Christians would just be happy if everything would go pretty much okay. I love when people get on Facebook. Yeah, my car broke down today. Worst time possible. I don't know. When's a good time for your car to break down? Boy, sure glad it broke down today! Most Christians are just happy being happy. And that's exactly what the liar wants you to think. Because if he... You realize Satan does a better job of making you happy than God ever does. Because that's not God's point. It's not his purpose. All the wonderful stuff that Rich Mullins wrote, one of my favorite things that Rich Mullins ever said, wasn't even a song. He said this. He said, Christianity doesn't answer all my questions or make me comfortable or happy. What it does do is give me a context for living. I know Southwest Christian Church isn't perfect. You're not there yet. Neither am I. In fact, next week when Perrin comes back, if you can deal with the volume level, he'll probably tell you a little bit about Philippians 3. And you'll hear about that struggle. We're not there yet. But we press on. Take hold of that for which Christ Jesus has taken hold of me. You're not there yet. But you have the best person ever to model your mindset after. The one who gave it all up. The one who became what the Father hates in order that we might become whom the Father loves. So keep planting and keep watering the seed that God has given you. Put on the glasses of humility and trust that his power is enough for you to be everything he created you to be. Church, and shine. Lord, come for you today. Because you are the one who is worthy. You are the only one who deserves the term superman. You gave up everything in order that we might know who it is that you are. That we might be cleansed and purified before the Father. You gave everything up in order to transform us. But Father, if we walk out of this place today just happy for what you have done, forgive us. Because what you have done has set the stage for what it is that we are to do. We are to continue to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. We are the ones who are to will and act according to your good purpose. We are the ones who are to stop complaining and arguing and instead be lights that shine, stars that shine as we hold out the word of life. Father, there is nothing in our faith that tells us that everything always has to be good, that we always have to be happy. But Father, we live our lives in such a way that we would be content just being happy. Father, forgive us for our arrogance. That somehow you exist to make us happy. Father, we exist to make you known. That is who we are. That is why we're here. So Father, help us. Help us to shop and shine.
As we sing our song of invitation this morning, if you have a burden on your heart that you'd like to come and lay at the foot of the cross, we invite you to do so. There's kneeling benches here on each side. Or if you just want to praise and thank Jesus for all he does, please do that. If you want to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, we can do that this morning also. So won't you come as we sing? close in prayer. Jesus, we thank you for this word today. We just thank you, Lord, for Tracy and the message. Father, may it weigh on our hearts. May we go out and be a shining light, your lighthouse. May we be a reflection of you. Thank you for going to the cross for us, Jesus, that we might be redeemed and righteous in you. May we sow seeds. May we tell others about you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Everybody, I got a table out there loaded with LCU goodies from Lindquist University. Please don't make me take any of it back. Take some stuff, grab some stuff. The brand new U books are out there. The new Restores are out there. Anything you want to take off the table, just don't take that tabletop banner because I kind of need that. But everything else is all yours. Please take it. Thank you.
We look forward to seeing Tracy again in 2 weeks.